Do you see anything going on one side or the other? This one over here? And I've reversed this. This is actually the right knee, but just to make it look like it's on the right side. But do you see the medial joint line? Bone on bone. This happens to be my knee. Oh, I got all sorts of sympathy there. Thank you. So here's the sunrise view. You can see the medial condyle it's kind of shifted here. It's a little hypertrophied, sclerotic, but I was informed by a surgeon. I was a candidate for a total knee about 4 years ago. In my history, I had tore my ACL skiing when I was in the Air Force and defending the Rockies against the communists. Tore my ACL. I also tore my medial meniscus. Back then, they just took the whole meniscus out. Now they try to just very carefully, and if you can repair it, they repair it. They reattach it. But you know they don't grow back. I didn't even know what a meniscus was, but he said it's like you have a hangnail inside your knee. And I remember asking him, well, when I have a hangnail, I don't remove the whole fingernail. I just remove the torn part and I file it down, but then it grows back. And you say, this doesn't grow back, but you take the whole thing out. And he said, well, you know, there are people that are just taking the torn part out, and I could do that if you want. And I said, well, you're the doctor. I never even heard of this till today, but I didn't. So what would you do? I said to him. So I take it out. So that's what he did. Well, they don't do that anymore. Bad decision, because what happens is then the ACL, if it's partially torn, then it tends to completely tear, and then over 40 years, you get that kind of a presentation. So back to this study, they took people like that, and at the end, they followed them up. A year later, 20% of the placebo group had elected to have a total knee. 5% of the other group, the intervention group, had elected to have a total knee. They all had the radiographic criteria. They were randomized, et cetera, but they were satisfied with their level of function. And again, like me, I didn't have my surgery. I saw one of the best total knee surgeons in town. Really respect him. His patients we see, they do great. That's why I went to him. He said, yeah, we can do that. And the other issue I just will mention, I think it's important. I was a little concerned that I was going to be sensitive to the metal that would be implanted. Because I'd say almost all of the implants have they have cobalt, chromium, molybdenum, and there's some nickel in there. And 1 in 7 people are allergic to nickel. That's 15%. Like, I can't wear a metal wristwatch band. I have to wear leather. There's some deodorants have an aluminum compound in them. So I can't use those. Those make me break out. So I have to pick others that don't have that. So I was a little concerned about some of these metal things. So I had myself tested against all the metals that any manufacturer uses in total knees and total hips. And it turns out I'm allergic to aluminum, I'm allergic to nickel, and vanadium, which is a relative of titanium. So, but one of my friend with the thunder, he told the surgeon there that I needed a total knee, so he had him call me up, and I was honored to even have him know my phone number and call me. Wanted his autograph at that point. And he offered, I'll do this total knee tomorrow if I've got an open slot, and we can do it. And he said, I use this certain knee, and I've used it for 12 years. It's great. It's called a 30-year knee. And it's the femoral component is primarily, it's called oxinium. Oxinium. It's a alloy, kind of oxygen-treated of zirconium, which few people are allergic to. But the tibial plate, I looked this up to find out what it's made of. It's made of titanium, aluminum, and vanadium, two of my three ones. And, well, he wasn't in my network as well, and so I had to then thank him for the call, but also politely decline, because I didn't know how much these fancy implants were going to cost. I needed to manage my costs. And that's when I went to see a different surgeon who was in the network and told me about a different implant that has 7 layers of zirconium chemically bonded to the outside that I would be probably very unlikely to be allergic to. But again, the test I had was a 10-day incubation period. What about 10 weeks? What about 10 months? What about 10 years? I'm leery that maybe I would develop a sensitivity over time. Much like when people who have seasonal allergies, they live in one location, they're clear for a while, but then 2 years later, they're allergic there. They move away, they're clear for a couple years, and then they have allergies there. So I'd rather live with the devil I know than the devil I don't. So I do all the things that I teach my patients to do, and it's not the best knee in the world, but it's the best one I got, and it doesn't hurt, it's not swollen. I manage it. I came up the 3 flights of stairs. I'm going to go down them as well. So, I live that long. All right. So that was that study. So what I'm trying to show you is that you can have structural and radiographic criteria for needing a surgery. But then again, there are things that we sometimes can offer that enable that person to have a functional level of that may be satisfactory to them. I mean, I can't do all the things I used to do by any means, but I'm satisfied with what I've got. And again, just think for a second, if you took an MRI or a plain film of a car's engine that wasn't running right, what could that snapshot of structure tell us? Well, there might be worn bearings, there might be carbon buildup, there might be something bent or missing, but what could it not tell us? Is the engine timing correct? We can't tell you that because it's a snapshot. Are the valves adjusted properly? Again, it's a frozen in time picture. You can't tell that. Will the engine even start? You don't know that. I remember a friend whose husband was a pathologist. They ordered an MRI of this very elderly, ill gentleman, and they put him in the machine, and he was back in the thing just viewing the images. They were crystal clear. Best images he'd ever seen. Well, sadly, the man died during the scan, so there was no breathing. So everything was perfectly still, and they got great images. But he didn't know that until after. So again, there's things you can't tell from these very powerful images. This is a potpourri of different areas of the body. There's been studies to show. Let's take the low back here. Mayo Clinic did a review of lumbar imaging, which we'll talk about in a second, but their sample size, 3,110 people, huge sample size. They're able to break them into age groups, people in their 20s, 30s, 40s, on up. These are people that did not have any back pain, and they looked at lumbar MRIs to see what would we see among people who don't have pain, because usually we order imaging when a person has a problem, and then when we see something on the imaging, we attribute their symptoms and problem to what we see. Well, people in their 50s, 80% who didn't have any back pain have disc degeneration. 36%, a little more than a third, have disc protrusion or herniation, which if a surgeon sees that, they're going to say, there's your problem, we'll operate tomorrow. And there's similar type things with these other areas. Again, not to talk against the imaging. I mean, I would want imaging if I had a problem, for sure. But then what do you do with it? I mean, there's things you can definitely see and find, but when it comes to do they have pain, it doesn't automatically tell you that. Is what you see responsible for the pain they do have? It doesn't tell you that. So here we go. Disorder of structure that may be asymptomatic. One of my other patients, 62-year-old male, disabling headaches and neck stiffness. PCP ordered plain films, noted moderate to severe degenerative changes from C5 through T1. MRI further substantiated diagnosis of cervical spondylosis. So he referred him straight to pain management because they were pretty significant changes. And he was treated with bilateral facet injections from C5 to T1. Well, you guys know your dermatomes. Where's the C5 area? Shoulder and maybe down the arm. It almost goes to the wrist. Okay, C6.
Thumb.
Right, and maybe the index. C7?
Middle finger,
yeah. So, but we're talking down here. Mm-hmm. This man had headaches. So would you think of C5? What comes out between C5 and 6? What level? Well, I mean, what spinal level? See, this is where it's tricky, because there's that, remember there's that, what's that nerve root that doesn't have a vertebra? C8 doesn't have a vertebra, but there is a C8 nerve root, right? So C6 comes out between 5 and 6, 7 between 6 and 7, 8 between C7 and T1. So, but we're down in those levels, and he's got headaches. So, see, from somebody like me, the process that I outlined before, we ask, where are the symptoms? What are the tissues that could cause those symptoms? Well, if it's going to be the neck, we're thinking upper neck, not these levels, right? And then the muscles that may be innervated up there. It might be, you know, if he has headaches and they're severe, he might have something non-musculoskeletal, right? Of course. And so we have to be alert for those kind of things. But if it is in our area and we find signs in the upper neck and those either worsen or improve his headache, then we feel we're on track. But if we work on those and it doesn't change the headache at all, for us that's a red flag. They might have a brain tumor or some other thing that's outside our area, right? So, but the first thing we we wouldn't be thinking of C5 through T1. But the pain management doctor did facet injections at the levels that really showed changes on the MRI. First round was unsuccessful. Second round was unsuccessful. The physician proposed a third round, because they do three, that's the standard deal. Patient declined, well then he referred him to physical therapy. So then I get to see him. So here's an example of some degenerative changes in the lower neck, but looking pretty good up above. So I know where his symptoms are. I make my mental list of what might cause those if it's musculoskeletal. So I start palpating in that area and I find this big knot of muscle and restricted movement at C2-3. And as soon as I get on that, which is the, you know, my students would find it first thing just like I did. You guys would find it if you palpated. And the patient just says, that's it. That's where my problem is. That's where I hurt. In fact, that kind of hurts good. You know, it sort of brings on the headache, but it almost sort of feels good. And so I did some things that we do, traction, manual therapy, pressure on the muscles to get them to release. When a muscle's in a contracted spasm, if you could somehow put a tourniquet around that muscle that's contracted and hold it for a while, deny it the blood flow that it needs to sustain a contraction, that muscle's gonna have to let go. You literally make the muscle itself pass out by constricting blood flow. So when you can palpate a knot or an area, if you just put steady pressure, sometimes you can't do it very hard because it's acutely sensitized, but in time you can get in there and work into it and you can get it to let go, you can feel it let go. So that's what I was doing, a little bit of traction, a little bit of mobilization. Made his headache go away, but then it came back. Saw him another time, same result, made it go away. So at least if I'm affecting it, I feel like we're barking up the right tree. But did it last? No. So it turns out he's a chaplain, he's a bioethicist, we're about the same age, he was an Army guy, I was an Air Force guy, we have a lot of kind of, we kind of had a good rapport. He said, what do I do? I mean, I had all these injections done. I said, well, he said, why didn't the doctor get up there where you are? And I said to him, with the best of intentions, I think the doctor was treating the MRI rather than the patient. It was kind of blunt on my part, but it seemed, he said, I think so too. And so he asked what I would do with that problem. I said, well, I'm friends with a pain management doctor who probably was this doctor's mentor when he went through the fellowship, who I think the world of, and I could write him an email and see if he would see you. I think he might, and I could tell him my findings. He knows me well enough, he would listen to what I say and at least give it a fair shake. So anyway, he went to see this other person. He did injections up there at C2-3, all his pain away. So you gotta bark up the right tree. So I'm both saying, you know, we have a role. It was helpful in getting the person to the right place. It was based on our way of looking at the problem, which again, relying on area of symptoms, palpation. The MRI is not informative to me for areas of movement disorder. It's a structural disorder. And anyway, the patient was happy. But then the issue is, you know, what about completing the loop with this doctor who did the lower cervical injections? I don't know him well enough to just say, hey, bud, here's the full story. I'm not sure how to handle that. We sometimes get ourselves in little awkward positions. You guys will too, probably, sometimes. Just we do our best to keep the team going and everybody having the same face. Ultimately, the patient's best interests are number one. We all have to take a back seat to that. I've certainly had people I've missed things on and other people have found and got them where they needed to go. There's no question about that. Okay, here's this issue of the Mayo Clinic article and just some, if you can see those numbers. Are you guys mostly, I'm guessing, in your 20s or 30s? Would that be about right? So you can see it for yourself, but I was just shocked. If you're in your 20s, what percentage of your age mates that don't have back pain have disc degeneration? 37%. To me, that's without any pain. Disc bulge, 30%. Disc protrusion, which again, a surgeon sees that, they're thinking there's the problem. 29%, almost a third. These are people without pain. All these numbers are a little higher for people who do have pain. You get up to my group up here, disc bulge, 69%, disc protrusion, 38%. It's really not all that much higher, but it does, all these increase with age. So when we have patients that have seen their doctor they've taken films and images and they are given this information and they're given a diagnosis of degenerative changes, for them this is often new information and they feel down, like, oh man, my back is degenerated. It's like it's rusted out or something, you know. And there's they come deflated a little bit to us with what can I do about the back, you know? And so I have a copy of this that I have on my desk, and I make copies for the patients, and I say, look, our job is to try to look, almost everybody has these kind of changes. And yours may be exactly what's causing your symptoms, but maybe we can teach you to move better or do, like, tuning up a car, helping you to tune it up. Maybe we can turn you into a person who has those changes and symptoms to a person who has those changes and doesn't have symptoms. Now, they may come back a little more frequently than the person who doesn't have this, but that's why we want to teach you how you can help yourself and how you can prevent it. But let's see if we can turn you into one of these people. And most people feel a little bit more positive that, okay, this is just part of living life. Again, a car with 60,000 miles on it or tires with that many miles, they're going to have some wear and tear. They might have even had a blowout that was repaired. They might have some dings, that kind of thing. But it's still, it's not like a brand new car that you can race and jump the tracks and skid around the corners, maybe, but you can still get some pretty good use out of it. Okay, so I've kind of covered those points there. I'd like to just, we've talked about the knee and the back a little bit, another example on the shoulder. And I think, you guys normally take a break at about an hour, is that it? Or about this time? Do you want to take a break now, or do you want to, this won't take long, that'd be a good break point here if we could do this. 65-year-old female, single mother, had worked 30 years flipping houses to support herself and her daughter. She hired out the heavy work, but she did the finish work, texturing the walls, painting, staining, woodwork, tile, light fixtures, curtains, curtain rods, all of that kind of stuff. She's right-handed. Over all of that overhead work, injured her rotator cuff, and it just got to a point that she pretty much retired from doing that work, but now she has time to try to deal with the shoulder problem. Sees a surgeon, and they do an MRI, full thickness tear of the supraspinatus, and tells her she needs a rotator cuff repair. She informs him she does not want a rotator cuff repair. Thank you. So here's an MRI, and you can probably know this better than I do, probably. There's a little tear right there. Right there. just see if you're awake. And there it is over there, big gap. She asks to go to physical therapy. And she tells me all this, so I obviously wasn't there during this conversation, but this is what I'm hearing. But physical therapy can't fix your supraspinatus. You've got a torn key tendon in your shoulder. The only thing that's going to fix that and give you a functioning shoulder is surgery. She says, yeah, but there's this guy. that he helped my daughter with her shoulder problem, my son-in-law, my grandson, and I want to see him. That happened to be me. And so he kind of reluctantly, as she tells me, writes a script, says, okay, here in 4 weeks, go see him, come back at the end of that, and then we'll schedule surgery. And so she comes to me, explains the whole thing, and well, it turns out I have a labrum tear in my right shoulder. I happen to be left-handed, but my supraspinatus isn't all that strong and active, and it's kind of atrophied. If you poke in on it through the supraspinatus fossa, there's not much there. My infraspinatus, however, I'm kind of proud of. It's massive, in fact. So I taught her to activate her infraspinatus. Maybe you can flip the lights back on, Sally, if you don't mind. Thank you. If I can kind of model this, if my palm is the glenoid, and here's the acromion over the top, here's the coracoid, coracoacromial ligament, here's the humeral head, okay? This is the lesser tuberosity, this is the greater tuberosity, so it's kind of in there like that. Supraspinatus is coming through and attaching right in there. Okay, infra is coming kind of from back and below over here. And so if I can activate my infraspinatus, which is directed this way, see, I could pull my shoulder down and back like that, my humeral head. I don't know if you can see, here's my massive muscle now. See if you can see this right there. You see a little movement?
Mm-hmm.
Which is different from my whole shoulder movement, right? So there, here, ready? Does anybody want to film this? Right there, okay? That means I can contract that muscle and relax this muscle. So I have do you know what a slap lesion is?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So superior labrum, anterior posterior, so like what, from like 12 to 3 o'clock over here? So if I raise my arm with my anterior deltoid, can you see how that would sort of pull it up into that area and pivot? But if I can pull it down and away, see, maybe I can have a slap lesion and keep that anchored, and if I move my arm carefully, like I have to do. So I do that, and then I can raise my arm, no problem. But I have a pathway of movement here that it's fine. And you guys know impingement tests, or you've talked about it, all those? Do you know the position where there is no impingement, or where there's the least likelihood of impingement? Well, let's teach you that. So, if you guys could stand up a second. So, if you just kind of shake your arms out a little bit, and if you have a shoulder problem and don't want to do this, don't feel obligated, but if you can, it'd be great. If you can just quickly, I'm going to do this, just flex your arms, let them go.
I got excited.
That was fun. Okay, now pause there a second, and then bend your elbows. And just look around, and do you see how basically everybody's arms, they're not in the sagittal plane, they're not in the coronal plane. They're in an oblique plane, right? That was through a flexion pathway. Now we're going to do abduction. Okay, just shake them out, get them, and then just kind of quickly do abduction. Yeah? And then once again, bend and see, do you see how I'm in that oblique pathway as my forearm is oriented. Okay, and if we then, there's a pathway we often call scaption. Is that a word you guys know? That's kind of on this oblique pathway here. So I'm going to, not flexion, not abduction, but sort of halfway in between. Is that fair enough, guys? Okay. So we're going to do halfway in between, scaption. So quick, and then bend, and same place. So regardless of pathway, you ended up in the same place. Okay. Now get an anatomical position, which is this way. Now if you bend your elbows down here, if you're really in anatomical position, your forearm should be pointing straight ahead. So go ahead and point them straight ahead, just to helps make my point. Now let me do this first and then you guys. I'm going to flex, okay, not my whole everything, I'm going to flex my shoulders, there we go, flexion. Now I'm going up like this. Now that final pathway that I have to get to, do you see how they have to internally rotate to do that? So you guys try it and just feel it in yourselves. You know, you may be flexible, some of you. No, go through flexion, you're going out here, go like that. There you go. But see, at the very top, they kind of want to turn in, I would think, for most people. So that's called conjunct rotation. That just has to happen to get to that final place. Now if we go to anatomical again, let me do it first, then you guys. If I do, I'm going to do it on this side, because this one I have to protect. I'm going to do abduction. So see how my forearm is pointing straight forward if I only do that. But to get to that final position, I have to externally rotate. Do you see how that... My greater tuberosity is lined up with lateral epicondyle, so it's right here. If I'm coming up like that, it's coming right under acromion. I've got an external rotator. See, now it's back here. To clear that, to get the rest of the way. So you could try abduction and just see if you can keep it pointed forward, and you can't go all the way. To go all the way, you have to rotate it. But if you're rotating it up high there, sometimes you get crunches and pains, so don't mess too hard with that. Yeah. You can take seats now. So that just shows that there are, our shoulders have to move certain ways. Well, that end position that we get to, if I just come straight down from there and not rotate either way, but just come down from there, and I end up close to arm by side. Do you see how my arms are oriented? Much like, have you seen like a sling and a pillow that people get after shoulder surgery? That's the position that people are put in because it's a very neutral position even down here. And see, all I have to do is a pure swing movement to get right up to my final position. There's no need for that rotation, internal or external. It's already oriented like it needs to be. So those tuberosities, they clear well all the way up and down. So we use that movement. We can do a swing like this, but to make it more functional, at the top I straighten the elbow, at the bottom I bend the elbow, but my upper arm is going through that swing movement. And then by adding the elbow movement, I get a straight line. So if I was going to paint this room with a long roller, I'd be doing like this. See, I'd follow that pathway. If I'm going to put stuff up on the shelves, I'm going to do it that way. If I'm going to lift an object over a tailgate, instead of lifting it up like this, see, I'm not in that pathway. I'm in an impingement pathway, right? And that, see, I feel it there a little bit. So I've got to come underneath and bend my elbows and then come up this way, lift it over like that, and change. So that's orienting the bones in a good way. But then there's this issue of muscle imbalance. I've got a pathology in there, not just an impingement. I've got a loose labrum. This other lady had a torn supraspinatus, which is a key stabilizer. But we got her infraspinatus, like mine, she could bring that down and back, set that. So at the end of her 4 weeks, she goes back to the doctor, and she brought actually a 10-pound weight in her purse to this physician appointment. And she's sitting on the table, she hears the chart rattle on the door, in he comes, she's got the weight, and she's just pumping iron here. Doc, here's my no pain, and I'm happy. Look what I did. And he was like, whoa, you know, that he didn't expect that. Now, she can't serve with a tennis racket. I mean, she can play ground strokes, and maybe she could do some, but she's happy with that result. She couldn't be a pitcher. She couldn't, you know, throw a softball very well. I mean, you got to kind of stay in this groove if you're going to need to do that. Like, again, I have a pathology. I'm electing not to have shoulder surgery. I elected not to have knee surgery and a few other things as well. I'm trying to manage it myself, considering it a movement disorder, and I can coexist with the structural problems. So, all right, let me just, yeah. This is a good break point if you'd like. I mean, I can keep going if you want to keep going, but I want to respect if maybe you need 5 minutes or something, whatever you want to do. 5 minutes?
Yeah.
5 minutes.
Thank you.